na unha. So we do not know what will happen. So that they are trying to keep the country open for Christmas, you know, for shopping, all to avoid closing and so to avoid the economy. But it is really difficult to keep everything open in a period. The only thing that was nice, at least in Italy, that it is the first time that we have a linear growth of people affected by the COVID rather than an exponential. So, and this was the first time that we observed as a statistician something like that, because in the past we had always an exponential growth of cases, and now we have linear. So we hope that it will keep linear.
Marcelo apologize, it's the time to start the third day of International Conference Use of R in Official Statistics. Welcome everyone. Today is a day dedicated to two tutorials, hands-on tutorials. So the participants are welcome to exercise together with the lecturer. And a panel talk in the afternoon dedicated to computing in the statistical office will bring along experts from official statistics from various institutions to discuss about this hot topic for R and the community. And I want to mention that today will be on WebEx just the lecturers and the organizers. And all the large audience will be available on YouTube links. They will access from there the conference. And you are all welcome to address questions during the tutorials and panel discussion on YouTube, and they will be transferred on WebEx. You will receive the answers also on YouTube. Have a good day and enjoy our conference in the last day. Thank you. And now is the time to give the floor to the first lecturer, Mr. Marcelo Dorazio from ISTAT, Italy, which will learn us about selecting auxiliary variables in R. Welcome, Marcelo. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Anna Maria. So it's a pleasure to be again part of these events, even if virtual events. So I will give this my presentation on this tutorial on selecting auxiliary variables in R. Okay, so this is a part of some tutorial that I gave some time ago in one of the previous conferences on the use of R in official statistics. And basically I've decided to, it was a part, but I've decided due to the request basically to expand this part and to make it as a standalone tutorial. So basically the idea is that of, you know, we have problems usually in official statistics in which we need to identify what we call the auxiliary variables. And these auxiliary variables basically are variables that are needed for some specific tasks that have to be performed. So basically, I will give you a short introduction on what we are going to do in this tutorial. And then I will try to show you some what I call simple methods, and then some advanced methods, including some supervised statistical learning techniques. So you can find all the slides and the R code jointly with the data that I'm going to use in this tutorial on this GitHub page that is public, so you can access there and take the R code, these slides that I'm presenting here, and also the data that I will use. Basically, our problem is that we have a y variable that is our response or dependent variable, and that usually in IT or terminology is our output. And then we have a number of independent variable, which can be considered as potential predictors of y. These are usually called the features or the input in the IT terminology. So basically, the problems that we face in most of our application is that of we need to select a subset of these independent variables that have to play the role of predictors of y. But the idea here is not that of fitting a model regression or a more complex model in which we try to explain well how the variability of y is explained by this predictor, but we need basically a working model for purposes like imputation, classification, estimated probability of a specific non-sampling error. So we need what we call working models, and basically these are some very common examples that you can find. For instance, often I have, as in the past tutorial, on the nearest neighbor donor imputation of missing values. And so the common problem is, okay, which are the variables that I should pick and use as variables to be used for calculating the distance? And recently, I spent some time working with labor force data, and in particularly, for instance, with the hours spent at working in the week. And we realized, for instance, at TSTAT that this variable is affected by several errors. And so basically one problem that we face often is the presence of underreporting. So the idea is, okay, given the fact that in labor force we collect a huge amount of variables, and also the fact that we can link the data collected in the survey with administrative data. So is there the possibility of identifying predictors which can indicate, for instance, the presence of underreporting of the hours? As well as, for instance, in labor force, we have also what we call contamination problem. So basically, we have observed a number of hours worked in the week, but we are aware that some hours are those that we call legal because are those regulated by a contract, but there is a fraction of hours which are worked on a legal basis, so not covered by the contract. It may happen in some economic activities in Italy, and so basically the idea is, so can we identify among all the available data that are collected in the labor force surveys or in administrative registers which are possible, let's say, predictors of the presence of hours working on, you know, in a legal manner. So these are just examples. So basically, we here are not searching for a model, but we are searching basically for a subset of variables that can be used for our purposes. So imputation, or to identify suspicious variables, or to identify, you know, the presence of a contamination of the variables. So these are problems mainly related to the treatment of data that we collected in our survey. Okay, so in this search, the problem is that we have an objective. And so the idea is that we cannot spend a lot of time in searching which are the what we call the the best predictors. So we need to have very fast and rapid tools which can identify a subset of what we call best predictors, avoiding having redundant predictors and keeping in mind the parsimony principles. So few and relevant predictors. Also because having few predictors when we are using parametric models simplifies a lot the models and the number of parameters to estimate. Obviously, in performing this work, this task of identifying this subset of not redundant and relevant predictors, we have to keep in mind which is the final objective of our analysis, which is the approach that we want to use. So a fully parametric model approach, so which means that we have to specify a model, or a non-parametric approach for which we do not want to specify a model, or a mixed one in which we have partly a model and partly a non-parametric model. Obviously, it is really important to which is the type of Y variable, and typically we distinguish between continuous and categorical variables. So a continuous variable is, for instance, turnover, income, consumption, expenditures. Categorical variables are professional status, education level, gender, and so on. And then we have the X variables. Usually we deal with data coming from surveys or from administrative registers or by the link between the survey and administrative registers. And therefore, usually we have many X variables, which can be all continuous or can be all categorical or can be, as in the most of cases, mixed type. So usually when we deal with household surveys, many of the variables are categorical, but then we have some of the few variables like age, and then if we are dealing with income related variables or consumption related variables that are continuous. So it is really difficult that we have a situation in which all the variables are continuous or all the variables are categorical. So typically we have mixed type situation. Another important factor to consider is the size of the data source. And in some cases, we have also to consider the source of the data. So basically, for instance, when we are dealing with the sample survey data, one important aspect to consider for some kind of analysis is the fact that we have a simple random sampling design, very rare in official statistics, or otherwise a complex sampling design, which includes multiple stages of selection and stratification. In some cases, basically, when we are dealing with administrative data, so we have with the source of data, which usually, obviously, it is not probabilistic, and the major difficulty with administrative data is in some cases to understand the coverage of this data with respect to the target population, because administrative data basically are tailored to solve some administrative functions, and sometimes the target population for the administrative function does not correspond to the target population from the statistical point of view. So, two important factors that should be considered together are, for instance, the size and the source of the data. So, basically, what is important in this case to consider is that if we use procedures that are based on using statistical tests and then looking to the p-values, the problem is that the outcomes of these procedures may be unreliable because, first of all, when we look at large sample, the effect of this large sample is that of determining the rejection of the null hypothesis. So, for instance, that a regression coefficient is equal to zero, in favor of the alternative hypothesis that the regression coefficient is a systematic different from zero, and then it means that that variable associated with the regression coefficient has an impact on the target variable. The other problem is that obviously often when we perform statistical tests, we work with the statistical test developed to deal with the simple random sampling, while the data come from a complex sampling design in which, for instance, the presence of cluster sampling makes the assumption of IID, independent identically distributed observation, no more valid. In particular, with cluster sampling, the observations are no longer independent. So, from my point of view, I would try to avoid, when possible, statistical tests carried out considering the sample as a simple random sample when dealing with the data from complex surveys. Just before starting with R, obviously, as we have seen that the factors that influence the type of analysis that I can perform is the type of variable. So the major distinction that we do in statistics is between continuous and categorical. And when we deal with categorical variables, we have categorical nominal variables in which the categories are not ordered, or the categorical ordinal variables for which the categories have a natural ordering, for instance, consider the education level. So in R, we have a different way of handling the variables. Usually, the continuous variables can be handled by what we call an integer R object or a numeric R object, while the categorical variables are managed by using the factors. And in particular, for ordinal variables, we can use the ordered factors. So when working in R, it is important that when we use some data, that the variables are correctly translated into the R variables. So for instance, what happens often is that when importing the data from a data source, it may happen that, for instance, we keep a categorical variable as a character variable in R, and this may create problem in performing or applying some procedures. So you have to spend some time when importing your data in R to try to have the variables that are correctly translated into the R, so categorical nominal variables that are preferably as factors, and the categorical ordinal that are ordered factor, and the continuous variables, age, for instance, can be defined integer or numeric, and usually this does not create great problems. Okay, so let's look at the methods, and I will start with the as I was saying, we have to perform this task, but this is not our final objective. So we need to identify some predictors of the target variable Y just to perform imputation. So we need to do something that will take a lot of time. So we cannot spend so much time in selecting these predictors. This is not our main activity. So for this reason, in some cases, I can just look at very basic methods that I call simple methods that takes into account the pairwise correlation between the variables. So a simple analysis that can be performed when dealing with a target variable that is continuous and a situation in which the axis, so the available potential predictors of Y, are all continuous or categorical or mixed type, is basically that of fitting a regression of the ranks of Y versus each X variable. So we consider each possible couple of Y and X, and basically when X is a continuous, we fit a linear regression model of the ranks of Y versus the ranks of X. If X is a categorical variable, we transform this variable through the dummies. Basically, we have not to do it, as I will show you. This is automatically done in R. Then, once we have fitted this regression model, we have just to estimate the adjusted R square of the model, and which is basically done by this formula. And obviously, higher values of the R squared, adjusted R squared, indicate that X has a strong effect on Y. The fact of working on ranks helps because basically this can help in identifying also nonlinear monotonic relationship between the variables. So we do not need to transform the variables because of skewed distributions and other things, but we can use simply the rank transformation because we need just to identify which are the predictors that the best predictors of Y, not according to a well-defined linear mode. So all this work should not be done. So the various steps are automatically implemented in a function that is called the Spearman-Chew in the R package, in an R package that called IHMISH, that is Harel Michelenia, and it is a series. The package includes a lot of functions that comes with a very well-written book on regression analysis from Harlem. So basically, let's move to R. Let me shift. Okay, so basically for working with R, I will use some data that are data from a real survey. The survey is basically a survey carried out in Pakistan, the Social and Living Standard Measurement Surveys carried out in 2014 and 15. The data from these surveys are publicly available as an R package, PSLM 2015. And here we have a lot of different data. I will work with the expenditure data and the variables were were modified using some code that here is in the package. But however, I created this data set that that has already the variables available for the analysis. So basically we have 24 variables in which we have some identifiers, the HH code, and other categorical variables indicating the province, the region, the identifier of the primary sampling unit, the gender, the age, in this case is integer, the marital status that is a factor with 5 level, and then we have a lot of additional variables that are household size, number of dependent household members, the expenses for food, the expenses for hotels, the expenses for furnishing, miscellanea, tobacco, housing, clothing, and so on. So basically, for our purposes, I will remove durable and non-durable goods because these variables are obtained as a linear combination with the other variables. And for our analysis, basically, I will look for potential predictors for the expenses for food. So I have a number of variables. I will start with a series of continuous predictors, that is the age, the household size, the number of household members being dependent, so the son, basically, and some other income and some other expenditures for different areas. And usually I will also include the household income as a final variable. So before looking to the Spearman correlation coefficient, I want just to show you which are the problems when we use for selecting the variable basically the fitting of a standard linear regression model and use the p-value, for instance, to identify which are basically the best predictors of foods. So just to fit a model, I use the RLEM function in R. And you see, basically, if you look to the analysis of variance table, that almost all the variables that I've included and predictors are statistically significant predictors of the food consumption, with the exclusion of tobacco and transport. So basically, according to this analysis, as potential predictors of food, I should include almost all the available variables that I've used as potential predictors. But here, the p-values are p-values calculated assuming that this sample is a sample. So we have 24,000 observations, so a very large sample. So that this is a simple random sample, that this is a problem, the first problem. And the fact is that most of these p-values here are statistically significant because of the size of the whole data set. So if, for instance, I just take a sample of 200 observations and then I refit the model of this sample, what happens is that you see that the results, if I look at p-values, are completely changed. And so really few variables now are relevant as predictors. So you see that this kind of analysis, when done with the large data sets that we have in official statistics, can provide different results. So here we have different problems. And so for this reason, I suggest not using the standard procedures, but for instance, using more advanced procedures that can be, for instance, the IEC criterion that is available in the package MASS. But let's now look at the RL package, HMISH. So basically, you see that we can calculate the adjusted R square without doing all the transformation. And then we just apply the formula. We give a usual formula, which is the target variable. Then we put a dot to identify that as potential predictors, it should consider all the variables other than food that are available in our data set. And then we run this procedure, and we get basically this table in which we have the adjusted R squared for the regression of the ranks of food versus the ranks of age, then versus the ranks of household size, and so the other variables. By looking at the values, you realize which are the variables that have more predictive power over the ranks of the food. And the variables are furnishing, so the expenses for furnishing. We see that the R squared is 0.47. Other expenses, miscellaneous expenses, 41. And then going down, you see the expenses for clothing. And then expenses, you see here, the household income that obviously has a great impact on. So if you look at this table, you can identify a few relevant are furnishing, other expenses, household income, clothing. Obviously, the problem is that, so I'm able to identify a subset, rapidly a subset of variables. The problem is that some of these variables may be redundant. So redundant means that some of these potential predictors carry out the same information as they are strictly correlated. So one possibility to identify rapidly which are the variables which show the predictors which show the highest correlation is that of doing a variable clustering, and the function is var class, that is a function of the Ariel Michelin package. So this performs an hierarchical clustering of the variables starting from a similarity matrix that is basically, so we consider all the potential predictors of food, and then we calculate the Spearman correlation, and we use the squared Spearman correlation as input of a clustering procedure. And we get basically this diagram here, in which we see basically, so two variables that are highly correlated are the household number, household size, and the number of members in the household in a dependent position. So basically, what means this kind of analysis, that in selecting the potential predictors, I have to use just one of these two, not both. And as I was saying, in the previous analysis, it came out that both furnishing and miscellaneous expenses were good predictors of food, but we see that these variables are highly correlated. So in this case, we just can select one of them that can be furnishing. And similarly, clothing and expenses for clothing or the household income are strictly related. So basically, we can select just one of these variables. We see that this cluster then is combined with the cluster of furnishing and miscellaneous expenses. It means that ideally, of these four variables, we just can pick up in the end, if we want to keep the number of predictors very parsimonious, one of these variables. And in this case, obviously, I will select the household income. So it is to see with this graphical analysis which are the variables that can be easily discarded, and so which are the variables that I can keep for the subsequent analysis. So as you see, with just a couple of procedures, so I identify rapidly which are the variables that I can use as predictors of food. So in my case, if I want to keep the things small, basically I just have to pick up the household size, this variable here, the household income, and then if you look at the other possible potential variables, you see that the clothing, it was related to the household income, so I can discard it. And so you can decrease rapidly the number of variables that you select for the subsequent analysis. As I was saying, now I was working directly with the potential predictors, which were only continuous variables. Obviously, the procedure works when I have predictors that are categorical. In this case, basically, we fit, the procedure fits a linear, regression model of the ranks of food versus the dummies of the categorical variables, so province, region, gender, and marital status. So basically, I include these variables in the analysis. You see that the variables have the province, have four possible provinces. So then we have region that can be distinguished in rural and urban, gender as two categories, and marital status as basically five different categories, where the latter one is very rare in our sample. So if we look now, you see that in correspondence of categorical variables, you have the degrees of freedom that increases because the variable is transformed into a categorical, into a dummy. And so for four provinces, I have basically three dummies. And you see that with the variables that we have introduced here, basically it seems that the province has not a real effect, while region, so being in an urban or region, rural area, affects somehow the consumption of food, so the expenses of food. And so you have the other variables. Just to show you what happens if we look for predictors of household income, and you see that for instance here, gender and region have the 9% adjusted R-square. So the results change, obviously, according to the variable that we use for the doing the analysis. So these are very rough methods that can be used in our analysis. So let me skip now to the presentation. Okay. Okay, what is important to say that this kind of analysis basically can be also applied when Y is categorical and all the axes are categorical. So in this case, basically we have to explore pairwise association measures. So we have to explore the association between Y and each available X variable. And here, the first suggestion is, okay, avoid the Cramer's V, because even though the Cramer's V, which is basically based on the transformation of the chi-square, is a measure that is included between zero, indicating no association, and one, that is the maximum association, the problem is that difficultly V will reach the maximum value. And the problem is that in the practice, as this measure depends on the number of row and columns in the table. It is, in the practice, I cannot compare measures of estimates of Cramer's V related to tables that have a different number of rows or columns. In our case, so the Y variable remains the same, but the X variable changes, so we have different categories of X values. So the main suggestion in this case is that of using proportional reduction of in error measures. These measures ranges from 0 to 1. In case they are 0, I have no error reduction. So it means basically that knowing X is not of help in predicting Y, while the case of 1 means that the error is fully removed and knowing X permits to fully predict Y. There are a number of pre-measures that can be in statistical. So some of them are the Goodman and Kruskal lambda, that is basically based on the contingency table crossing Y and X, or the Thales uncertainty coefficient, that is basically based on the entropy. All these measures are calculated by PW ASSOS function that is in my package statistical matching. The only problem here to face is that the results may be unreliable in case of large sparse table. So in the case in which we have sparse table means contingency table in which there are many cells which zero values falling out. Okay, before going on, I've seen that there is a question, if I'm not wrong. Okay, let me see if I can. Visualize the chat. Okay, let me in the chat. How do you determine that the correlation coefficient is high enough for the variable to be used in the model? They are all significant higher than zero. Okay, so basically, first of all, the first message is that you have to forget the p-value. So again, forget statistical test and p-value, as the sample is not a simple random sample. So we are not looking for something that is significant, but you are just considering that you are looking at something that in the case of Spearman, so when both y and x are continuous, you are looking to the squared Spearman correlation coefficient. Squared Spearman correlation coefficient means that basically, you know, usually we consider as moderate correlation values that are closer between 0.4, 0.5. So it means that you are considering the squared values, something that is considered as moderate correlation being equal to 0.5 squared becomes 0.25. So if you consider as, let's say, high correlation, something that is higher than 0.6, it means that the squared value is basically 0.36. So in theory, from the analysis that you do from R Studio, so I usually consider something that is interesting, something that is as a value of the R squared that is greater than the 30%, basically, if we look to very high correlation. Then obviously it depends from the situation, because in this case you have some variables that are there have strong correlation, but it may happen that in some cases you have variables that have a very low correlation, and then you have to pick up as predictors the variables that are basically those having not really high predictive power, so those that have a moderate predictive power. So remember that here we are not building the model for having a model that explains the relationship between y and x. We need to build a working model in which the predictors of y are then used for other purposes like imputation and so on. So everything depends on the objective of the analysis. So we are not building a model. So remember, I'm not explaining how to build a model in which I want to have, you know, a model that holds for the population and which can be used for the analytical purposes. It's just a model that I have to use for data treatment purposes, basically. So identifying, calculating the distance between the observation for imputation purposes, or identifying the potential identifiers or some strange situation. Okay, so if there are no additional question, let me turn to sorry for this, I have not optimized the presentation. So basically what is interesting of the, so we were dealing with as I was saying, y is categorical and all the axes are categorical. This may happen, for instance, when working with household surveys. So we can use some pre-measures. In some cases I can also use IC or BIC criteria, which are part also of the PW assoc function in the stat match. However, if you want to work with this criterion, you can refer to the CatDep package, in which the nice feature of this package is that it uses the IC criterion to identify a subset of the available predictors that not marginally work better, but that jointly work better as predictors of Y. So When working with categorical predictors, we have to consider that when fitting the models, you can consider which is the effect of a predictor marginally considered, or for instance, you can consider basically the joint effect. So in our case, in the Pakistan case, when considering the province and the region, so I can consider their joint distribution and so see which is the rural and urban regions within a given province, within each province. And so basically I search for the combination of the two variables as predictors of the target variables. So this package, CartDep, is interesting because it uses the IC not to identify the single predictors that alone work better, but to identify the predictors that work together jointly. And the nice feature of the IC criterion is that we have a penalty related basically to the number of parameters. So it tends to penalize subset of variables that joint considered as have many cells. And as I was saying before, the problem with the categorical variables is the fact that we can have basically tables that are very sparse. So with many cells that have zero, and so we do not know how to treat them. So I will not give you the details. Obviously, the IEC criterion can be used also when Y is continuous and the axes are all continuous or mixed type variables. And so the formula remains the same with the penalty that is basically related to the number of parameters to be estimated. And in this case, for instance, one function that can be used, as I was saying before, is the step IC function in the R package, MASS from Venables and Ripley. Or if you want, you can use another package that is GLMultif, which has facilities for IC-based selection of the best model and has an interesting feature, it handles also generalized linear models. Okay, however, in my point of view, when dealing with regressions, probably the best way to select the subset to identify the subset of predictors in a parsimonious manner is that of using linear regression models with a regularized or constrained parameter estimation, where the objective is basically that of simplifying the model, so removing the predictors, forcing the estimation of sum of coefficients to be close to zero. So in this case, the methods that can be applied are ridge regression or Lasso. Basically, the major difference is that the ridge regression does not remove the predictors, but just forces some coefficients to be close to zero, but not equal to zero, while the lasso forces some of the estimated coefficient to be equal to zero, and this means removing the value. So this regularization, when fitting the regression models, is controlled by a tuning parameter that can be decided by the practitioner or can be selected using, as we will see, specific methods. So the lasso that is interesting basically aims at minimizing this function with a loss term that is an LN norm of penalty term based on the regression coefficients. So I will not go into the methodological details. There are many generalizations of the lasso characterized by different ways of specifying this penalty. The problem with lasso is that it is very effective in reducing the number of predictors in linear regression models, but suffers of high multicollinearity between predictors. So it means that it is not able to identify, as we have done previously using redundancy analysis, which are predictors that bring the same information because are collinear, so are highly correlated, and therefore, for practical purposes, we can pick just one of them and discard the other. So in this case, basically, the suggestion from the authors of the package, the R package, is that of the shift towards an elastic net that combines, basically, different penalty terms. And both lasso, ridge regression, and elastic net, so all these methods are implemented in the R package, very famous package, GLMNet, that was developed by Friedman and other authors starting many years ago. So that now we have basically the version 3 and above of the function. So the main function to consider here is the GLMNet function. And there are a number of arguments that we should provide. So first of all, we should separate the matrix with the candidate predictors, X. Then we have to separate y is the vector with the values of the response variable. Then we should specify which type of model we want to fit. So standard linear regression is Gaussian family. It means that y is continuous and x's are continuous, or as I will show you, some of them can be categorical, but we can fit also a logistic model when, so we have binary variables, y is takes the value of 0 or 1, the Poisson when y observed the counts, so the number of times that we have seen a given event, or a multinomial when y is a categorical multinomial variables with more than two unordered categories. So basically then we have the alpha parameter that is a parameter that should range in the interval 0, 1. 0 indicates that is fitted the ridge regression. 1 means that I fit a lasso, while a value between 0 and 1 creates basically a mix between the two. And then the tuning parameter is lambda. So we should specify how many different values for this lambda should be tried in fitting the model. And this regulates, as I was saying, the penalty, because the lambda is, you see here, so is the term that regulates the penalty. Obviously, if you set lambda to zero, means that we fit a standard linear regression model without penalty. So we have values of lambda other than zero. And obviously, the higher is the value of lambda, the higher is the weight that we give to the penalty, and it means that the higher will be the number of coefficients, and so the variables that are discarded by the model. So to identify the value of lambda that minimizes the mean square error, it is suggested to apply the cross-validation that is implemented in CVGLMNet function. So we can or fit the model just giving the number of different values of lambda that should be tested, or we can say to the procedure to select the lambda that minimizes the mean square error by using the CVGLMNet function. Okay, just to end there with the GLMNet and then go to the example, we can say that starting from version 3, it was introduced a relaxed lasso, which has two steps basically. First, it's a GLMNet object, and then for each lambda value, it is fitted a model without the penalty. And this way of working is found very efficient and effective in reducing the predictors very rapidly. The other things to say is that GLMNet can handle different target variable, Y variables, continuous, categorical, nominal, binary, and also counts, but can handle mainly continuous predictors and few categorical predictors. I would say few, because basically the fact is that categorical predictors are transformed into dummies, and basically in carrying out the analysis and in fitting the this constrained regression model, the dummies are treated as separate variables, which is not obviously a situation which is effective in the practice. Okay, so let's skip now to the R. Okay, so I will not install GLMNet. I have already installed on my machine. So let's start with a very basic example. So we search for predictors of food. So Y is a continuous variables, and we use XS. XS is a subset of only, you see that XC is the subset of categorical predictors, potential predictors, while XS is basically the subset of all the continuous predictors. So let's take the simplest example, basically. So we fit the model. It is very rapidly in fitting the model. And basically, when you get the print of the function, basically, you have the lambda value, and then you have the percent of deviance of y that is explained by the model. So the first model that we consider is a model with 2 degrees of freedom, means that we have basically 2 predictors that are introduced into the model, and it explains 6.45% of the total deviance of y. So with the 2 predictors, we can arrive to explain the 22% of the deviance of y with a lambda value of 0.26. If we go with 3 predictors, we see that we go up to 33% of the total deviance. And then we see that if we increase the predictors, with 4 predictors, we arrive to 45%. Then with the 5 predictors, we just only increase to 47%, with 7 to 48, with 8 predictors, we arrive to basically 52%. And so on. You see that obviously by increasing the number of predictors in the linear regression model, basically we do not have really a huge increase in the percent of deviance of y that is explained by the model. So, we can have some graphical display of the results. So if I get the zoom here, you see basically here the value of the coefficients. So you see that first of all, the coefficients that are set to 0 are the coefficients that initially are very close to 0. And then the more we increase the number, the value of lambda, the later we see that we have a coefficient that initially had a value that was 0.20 and then are set basically equal to 0. So the first coefficients that become 0 are those that initially are already 0. And so here again, you see the value of the coefficient and the fraction of deviance explained. So basically you see that here, you have the different situation in which you can you see how the function works. Basically, if you want to see which are the coefficients that you have to keep, for instance, with a value of lambda of 0.7858, this value is basically the value that we observe here. So 7 predictors that explain basically the 48% of the variance. So you just have to call coef GLMNet with that value of lambda. And so basically the coefficients are They intercept the household sites, furnishing or miscellanea, housing and clothing, communication and recreation. You see that household income is removed basically by the model. The problem, as you, if you remember the previous analysis, is that basically, if you remember of redundancy analysis, in practice, some of the identified current predictors are predictors that are highly correlated. And so, therefore, the problem of this lasso is that it is not able to identify basically and remove collinear predictors. Obviously, you can use cross-validation to select the value of lambda. In this case, I use 10 folds, so 10 different subset. The data set is split into different subset, and then and we get basically the value that minimizes the mean square error is this value here. And so if we look at which is the model that is selected by minimizing the model is basically the full model with the exception of transport. However, if we just relax a little bit of value of lambda that is identified by cross-validation, so the maximum lambda value within the confidence interval of one standard error, we see that the value is, in this case, identified at 0.06, and then the variables that are selected into the model is slightly reduced. What I said before is that obviously, if you want to reduce a lot the number of variables and also take into account a little bit the multicollinearity problem, you can help the procedure by fitting a relaxed lasso. So you have just to add here in the function argument relax equal true, basically. And so we see that here again it is very rapid. So basically, now with the relaxed lasso, we reach the 50% of the deviance of the food expenditure that is explained with four predictors. If we pick the model corresponding to the value of lambda of 11.4, basically you see that again the model is reduced only to a few relevant variables, household sites, furnishing, miscellaneous, housing, and clothing. Obviously, also with the relaxed lasso, you can identify, you can use cross-validation to basically try to pick which is the value for selecting the best value of lambda, that is the one that minimizes the mean square error. I have to say that, as I was saying, given that our procedure is that of not creating the model that explains the food consumption, given the available predictors, but we need, for instance, as we wanted to impute some food expenditure, which are the predictors of food expenditure that I can use for building an imputation model, you see that obviously I prefer looking directly at this table here, so the output, and so you realize that basically with just four of the available predictors, you explain about the 50% of the deviance, and just increasing the number of predictors, you see that you do not have with this model a very high increase of the percentage of variance, because it you in the best scenario, you can arrive to 53%. But if with four, you can reach 50%, I would say that, okay, I would prefer stopping with just four potential predictors. If there are no questions on this, I will show you basically how it works when we have mixed type predictors. Basically, the idea is that, okay, I have to first transform potential categorical predictors into dummy. So I have to use this makex. Makex basically, if a variable is continuous, remains as such. If a variable is categorical, it is transformed and replaced by the corresponding dummies. So in this case, I'm adding both four potential categorical variables that can be used as predictors. These are province, region, gender, and marital status in my case. So I get this matrix. Okay, the matrix is, you see, you have a dummy for each province, KP, Punjab, Sindh, Balochistan, then you have region rural, region urban, gender male, gender female, and all the possible dummies for the marital status. Then basically, when fitting the relaxed lasso, instead of providing as X the starting data, you should provide the output of the makex procedure. So basically, you see that it is very straightforward. Then again, you have this output, and you see easily that again you reach the 50% of the deviance of Y that is explained by basically four of the predictors. So if we pick the value, the model that is fitted with a lambda of 0, 10, 39, basically that is this value, so five variables that is playing 52%, you see that here now you have for each dummy that is treated as a separate variable. So basically no one of the categorical variables that were included into the model seem to have to be predictors of the food consumption, while we identify as usual the variables that were identified in the previous analysis. So remember, the problem is that with this analysis, for instance, it may happen that the province Punjab is relevant, but not the other provinces. But in this case, as this is a dummy that is created considering the province, for the final analysis, basically it means that I have to get all the original variable into the analysis. Maybe I can decide whether it is the case of transforming it from four categories to just two categories, whether the province is Punjab or not Punjab. So this can be one possibility. But usually when just one of the dummy created by the makex function is considered relevant as a predictor of Y, then we have to include all the categorical, the whole categorical variable into the additional analysis. So this is basically the rule to work with. So basically here there is an example on how it works when we are fitting a logistic regression model. So basically I create a binary variable that is a transformed of the expenses of tobacco. So basically if the expenses are greater than zero, I get one. If the expenses are equal to zero, I get zero. So if you see basically the sum, we have that about less than 50% of the observation have expenses related to tobacco. Then again, I consider all the possible variables, both continuous and categorical, and I transform. Then, when fitting the GLM net, the relaxed lasso, I just have to change here the family as a family binomial and the Y variable. It will take a little bit of time to fit. And now, basically, obviously, remember that when fitting a logistic model, it is more straightforward the interpretation of the deviance of Y that is explained by the model, but in general, For instance, if I take the model with the lambda of 0.02, basically you see here, as I was saying, so the intercept is relevant, then the province is Punjab, the fact of being in rural, and so in this case you have to keep province, you have to keep rural, the gender, basically, and then you have other variables, recreation, income, housing, and miscellaneous expenses, age, and household size. Okay. Just leaving a little bit the example of Lasso, I just want to give you an idea of how it works with the pairwise association measures. In this case, I will use the function of pairwise association in the Funkenstat match. I will use some sample data that are come along with this package. The sample B basically is artificial data sets which resemble the data that are usually collected in USIRC survey. So we have a few variables, but most of them are factors. So we have a household identifier, then we have the area, Italian area. So we have five district, five different areas, northeast, north, west, center, south, and islands. Then we have the urbanization level, then the household sites. The household sites cut to five. So 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, where 5 means that 5 household members and more. The age of the household member, the age categorized in 5 classes. Gender, marital status, education level, and then labor status. So then in using the PBSOC function, basically I have to specify which is my target variable, in my case the professional status, labor 5. Then we have all the potential predictors here. In this case I'm just specifying categorical potential predictors because this function manages only variables that are categorical, so categorical response variable and categorical predictor. So I consider the area, urbanization level, the household size cut to 5, the classes of age, the gender, marital status, and the education level. So you see that basically it calculates all the possible measures, including the V and the bias corrected V that I suggest not to consider, but this is mutual mutual information, normalized mutual information, the lambda, tau, U, tails uncertainty coefficient, AC, and BIC. And this is the number of parameters, so the cells in the table. So basically, this is the lambda value when only area is used as predictor of the labor 5. So if I look just the tails, you see basically that as the classes of age is a very good predictor of the professional status, and basically this is the best in our case, then we have very also the education 0.8. So consider that here the U value can range from 0 to 1, but it is really difficult that it reaches the value of 1. So values of 0.24 is a value that it can be considered quite high. And so basically, for instance, if I have to consider in this example, which are the predictors to include as predictors of the professional status in this data set, I would consider the age and the education level as the major variables. Then you can decide whether to include, for instance, the marital status and also the gender. But if you have to keep with a few variables, you just have to include age and education level. What is interesting to say is that basically you can use also the survey weights in estimating this association measure. In this case, basically the survey weights are used to estimate the relative frequencies in the contingency table, and then these relative frequencies basically are used for estimating the measures. And so basically you see that in this case, using the survey weights, the results remain almost the same, because 0.24 and 0.24, you know, you just have a slight decrease. Basically, you have also IC, BIC, and TETAR calculated. If you want to go measure, if you would prefer working with IC or BIC, then I suggest you to shift toward the CATLAP package, because it is more tailored to this specific situation. So from this point of view, basically, I just covered a small subset of all the methods that I can use. But as I was saying, the objective of this tutorial is not that of giving you all the possible methods, but just giving you an idea on which are methods that are simple to apply, fast to apply, and which are effective in producing results. Because as I was saying before, the objective of the analysis is not that of identifying the best model, but the objective of the analysis is that of identifying a working model for the subsequent analysis that I have to perform. So I cannot spend too much time basically in fitting models and identifying the best predictors, the interactions, and so on. So I prefer just very rough models to be used in this case. Okay, before leaving and ending my morning presentation, I want to move towards something that is, let's say, common nowadays, and is basically the fact of using statistical learning methods. So we know that these methods are becoming very popular, not currently in the national statistical offices, even if in during this conference we had some interesting presentations related to the use of some statistical learning and mainly XGBoost package and routines for prediction purposes. But the idea is that, you know, statistical learning techniques are very important when we want to extract important patterns and trends and understand this unknown relationship between variables in large data sets. And then we want to learn from the data without having starting with some ideas initially. So in particular, for our purposes, we will look to supervised statistical learning methods, in which we want to build what we call a model in a very generic manner that is used to predict the output variable y, starting from one or more input variables. So the model is specified in this term. There is an error term, but then we have an function f of these input variables, which usually in statistical learning techniques is not known. It's a fixed but unknown function of the inputs. Supervised statistical learning is different from unsupervised statistical learning, in which we do not have an output. And basically, for instance, we want just to explore the association structure between the inputs or to perform the cluster analysis. In our case, the idea is that, okay, we have a target variable, we have a very high number of input variables, and then we want to identify relationship between y and x, also trying to discover nonlinear relationship, which, for instance, the lasso that fits linear regression models may be not able to identify. Generally speaking, we say that we fit a model, but in the practice we use algorithmic methods because we use simple or complex algorithm to identify basically the subset of the inputs that can be used to predict basically the output. If we look to a very the philosophy of statistical learning methods, basically, since we want to learn from the data, the first thing to do is to split the starting data set in two subsets: the training data set, that is basically the subset of the data that is used to estimate the unknown function and to tune the parameters of the algorithm, basically. And then we have a test data set in which we want to test what we have trained on the other subset. So basically, in our case, since we are working with supervised learning, we want to look how accurate is our model in predicting the target variable. Basically, one of the major difficulties with statistical learning models methods is the identification of the tuning parameters, and often the problem is that of going with overfitting. Overfitting means that basically we tune and the method in a way that basically the training mean square error is much smaller than the test mean square error. And if we want to use a less technical terminology, overfitting means that basically some random patterns in the data, so something that happens just at random, is identified by our algorithm as a systematic pattern, so something that has an effect basically on the outcome. So basically, this is not true because it was a random pattern. Okay, so if we, the nice thing of statistical learning methods is that they can identify complex relationship between Y and some of the available axes, can handle often, not all the statistical learning methods, but a large fraction of them can handle mixed type predictors, so that can be continuous and categorical. And for our purposes, most of these methods often provide a score that indicates the importance of the predictors in predicting Y. So the idea, and I've seen many applications, to be honest, of application of statistical learning methods just basically to get a score that indicates the importance of predictors and use these scores to select the best predictors. This is a common practice. The problem is that a caution should be used in interpreting this course because sometimes for practical purposes, these scores are not reliable. So in our situation, basically why and which are the reason for applying statistical learning methods. So I have seen some application in official statistics in which the practitioners say, okay, we have a situation in which I have a very large data set, a target Y variables, and a lot, a high number of X variables. These are mixed type variables. I know that there can be a nonlinear relationship between Y and the axis. And so I want to use a method that is fast and rapid in identifying which are the most important predictors of my target variable. And as I want to identify also nonlinear relationship, I fit these statistical learning methods. And here the idea is also the fact that in some cases, basically, you do not have to start with a model, you do not have to indicate a model. So for instance, if I'm working with a linear regression model, maybe, as I was saying, it may not be a good model for the situation. And so let's say we have an algorithm, and this algorithm can help me in provide some scores that I can use in identifying the best predictors. So basically my suggestion is be careful in using this scores. And to show the problem, I will start with very basic and well-known statistical learning techniques, that is the classification and regression trees. Maybe many of you knows how this works. We have a recursive partitioning of the observation using each time one of the available predictors of the Y variables. The idea is, okay, I use the variable of this predictor to split the observations of Y in two subsets in order to get two subsets that are homogeneous with respect to the Y values. And basically, when I fit this type of classification and regression tree, when I plot the tree in the end of the procedure, the experts say the predictors that appear in the top of the tree are those that are usually most important in predicting Y. If we look at R, we have several packages for fitting classification and regression trees. Most popular ones are tree or R part. But if we use a basic classification and regression tree just for selecting the variables, the problem with the classification and regression tree is that we know that this procedure is affected by selection bias. Basically, when I need to select a predictor for splitting the observation, obviously, it is easier to split observation using a predictor that allows many potential splits rather than one that permits only few potential splits. So, for instance, a continuous variable means that I can do as many splits that I want because I can decide to cut at any point of the range of the X variable. Otherwise, if I have a categorical variable, it means that I can split only the observation according to the value. So if I have education level, so I can split the observation with an education level below a certain education degree and those with above an education degree. If I have gender, I can split only according to male and female. So basically the idea is that in this selecting the potential predictors on Y, this procedure tend to favor continuous variables to categorical one. And when I have categorical variables with many categories are preferred to categorical with few categories. In addition, this procedure are not able to account for collinearity between predictors. A good idea, therefore, is try to improve. So the first suggestion that I can give, okay, don't use standard classification or regression tree, but instead use the random forest, because random forest compensates some issues of the basic trees. So the idea here is that each tree is a fit starting from a bootstrap sample of the observation. And when building the tree, at each node, not all the potential predictors are considered, but just a random subset of the available predictors, which is the square root of the number of predictors in classification problem or the integer part of one third of the predictors in regression problem. So here, the important score is provided by the argument importance set equal to true. And basically here, we get the first problem because we get two different scores. So the first one is the percent increase in mean square error, which is computed basically from permuting the out of bag data. Out of bag data means that, as you can see, at each iteration of the procedure, I select a bootstrap sample. So what remains out and I fit the tree only on the selected sample. The observations that are outside the bootstrap sample are called out of bag data. But basically, I use this observation because I use this observation basically to test what I fit on the bootstrap sample. So I get basically the prediction this out of bag portion of the data that is recorded. And then I see if I predict correctly the value or the category. So error rate for classification, mean square error for regression, and then this is done after permuting each predictor variable, and the difference between the cases is averaged over all the trees, and the normalized version of the score, or the standard deviation of the differences, is basically returned. Then the other one is much simpler to be interpreted because it's the total decrease in the node impurity, where node impurity is measured as the Gini index for classification and residual sum of square for regression. So the total decrease in node impurity from splitting on a given variable is averaged over all the trees. So I take over all the trees that have been fitted, and when a given variable has been used in fitting that tree, I see which is the total decrease in the Gini index in classification or in the residual sum of square. Okay, so basically, let's try to go into the R okay. Okay, I will not. So, for instance, here I can use the library tree and fit the tree. As you see, the procedure is okay, tree, provide which is the target variable, tilde, and dot, that indicates all the potential predictor variables other than food that are available in my data set. Then, if I plot the tree, basically what I get is this output. And so you see that the first variable that is used for splitting the observation is the furnishing, then the household size, then the household income, and then again in here, furnishing and household income. So basically, according to a basic tree, I should use as potential predictors just furnishing, expenses, household size, and household income. These are the variables that were used in fitting the tree. Let's now look at what happens with the library random forest. So as you see, basically, I have to use the same syntax. So the formula specifying which is the target and the potential predictors, all variables other than food in my case. Then the number of trees that will be fitted. And as I want a measure of the importance of the predictors, I set importance equal to 3. Here I will fit only a limited number of trees, just 50 trees, but usually we go with at least 500, but now for purposes, as it will take time, and I, at home I do not have a very powerful machine, I will use only 50 trees, and you see that it will take a little bit of time to fitting 50 trees, but usually you have to fit, let's say 500 commonly. Okay, sorry for the delay, but obviously the size of the dataset is the other factor that affects the slowness of the function, because with a small dataset the procedure is much faster. Here we are dealing with a large data set with 24,000 and more observations, so it will take some time. And the larger is the data set, obviously, and the higher amount of memory you need on your machine. So the problem with some algorithmic procedures that you need, as they are based on algorithm, you need a very powerful machine to run these procedures. And so even a basic random forest can take some time when dealing with a very large data sets in terms of both number of records and with many variables that should be considered as predictors, as potential predictors of the target variable. A nice important feature, as I was saying, of this procedure from the other side is that obviously as they are algorithmic, and so I do not have to specify a model, they can handle easily a situation in which I have mixed type of predictors, in which so I have categorical, many categorical and continuous variables. Even though, for instance, one problem that we may face mainly when we have this kind of data related to expenditure is the semi-continuous variables. And so the fact that basically there are variables which can take a value of zero, meaning that there are no expenses, or a value greater than zero. And in this particular variable, in some cases, are difficult to be handled even by these non-parametric methods. And so I do not have a solution for this problem. In some cases, you can create a dummy and then you use first the dummy and then use the variable or create subsets. So as I was, now I have my output. So basically, if you fit, you see that basically the fitted forest was able to explain the 63% of the variance of the food expenditure. And if you look at the importance of the predictors, you see that the most important predictors, if we look at the increase in node purity, are furnishing and miscellaneous expenses, and followed by the household income. And then with less values, we get different results. So for instance, clothing here, then we have household sites. Why for the categorical variable, it seems that they are not really powerful predictors. But the major difficulty that we face in this case is that if we look at this score, we get with some results. If we look at the other important measure, basically we get a different picture because, for instance, in this case, the province come out to be the most important predictor of the variable, followed by the region, furnishing, housing, and so you see that basically the two scores within the same procedure give a different results. So from my point of view, I would say that basically I do not have a rule to identify. Obviously, from a practitioner point of view, it is easy to understand what is this increase in node purity. And so since it is easy to understand in practice what it is, because it is basically the reduction of the node purity every time that a variable has been used in building the tree. So basically, I understand that furnishing and miscellaneous expenses were very important in decreasing the node, in increasing the node purity, followed by household income. The other measure is much more difficult to be interpreted by a practitioner, and so I can say that generally the practitioner prefer this, but there are no rules to decide which is the best. Obviously, you can also decide to give a graphical representation of the two measures, and so you see here it is very easy to see that with the first measure, province is the highest value, and so you see that graphically it is even easier to identify the jumps in the scores. So for, and also in the second case, you see that from furnishing to income, there is a big jump. Then there is a jump from income to miscellaneous expenditures, then clothing, household sites, and then probably all the other one we have the values that are become smaller but closer. So ideally you have that one should look at first at this variable, then maybe can mix the first three variables, or if we want to get a larger subset, one should select the first five variables. But again, also random forest is not able to solving the problem of collinearity, because if you remember that redundancy analysis that we have done with the clustering of the variables, the household income was somehow related with some of these other variables, and so probably it is carrying out information that could be so for instance I could decide to remove the clothing, the expenditure for clothing, and get, because it is related, if I'm not wrong, with furnishing of the household income. Practically, I have to say that obviously, if you want to work with the tree, probably even random forest is not the best way of working with the scores. And some practitioners say that if you want to avoid all the problems related to the trees, you should shift toward the conditional inference trees, where you have the conditional forest in the package party. And here you have also a varimp function that returns the importance of predictors just in terms of mean degrees of accuracy. The feature of conditional inference tree is that when you set the argument conditional equal true, the importance score is calculated by permuting the predictors most linked to Y. And this device of basically random permutation of the predictors most linked to Y usually compensates for multicollinearity between the predictors. So the conditional inference tree basically solve both the selection bias problems as well as the multicollinearity between the predictors. So in the code, you will see that there is an application related to the conditional inference tree. I will not run the code because obviously adding an additional device here, that is the random permutation of the predictors when calculating importance score from the practical viewpoint, means that we need more time to run the whole procedure. And so here again, the major question is, you need to find a balance between the time that you need to spend to identify a subset of variables that should be used in subsequent analysis and in treating the data. So that's why usually I say that this is an important problem that, however, should be approached using a simple and fast tools, because in most of the cases I need much more time to solve my subsequent problems related to the data treatment, to you know, harmonizing the variables, transforming the variables to be correctly identified by R. So treating the data requires a lot of time before fitting the procedures or and the algorithmic method. When we go with statistical learning methods, many of the statistical learning methods that have been introduced in literature provide an estimate of the importance of predictors. Practically, a good package that can be used to fit many of the statistical learning methods is the current package, Classification and Regression Training, which is continuously updated and, by the author Kuhn, that is also the author of a very well-written monograph on statistical learning methods. Then there are a series of additional packages that can be used in analyzing and interpreting the results of these fitted methods. And if we look at this package, for instance, we have a package var-imp, which is basically tailored uniquely to analyze the variable importance measure. So as many ways of graphically representing the scores related to variable importance. And so it, you know, you have these graphical facilities to better interpret the results. I will not go into the details of the different packages. I just want to end my morning presentation that if you are going towards the statistical learning methods, and as it was shown in presentation in the previous days, one very efficient and effective method in prediction problem is extreme gradient boosting, XGBoost method, because basically it is an implementation of a gradient boosting procedure in which basically I have boosting. Boosting means that there is a combination of a series of weak procedures, for instance, classification and regression tree. So I perform iteratively, I fit iteratively classification and regression trees, but these iterations are not independent as in random forest, but are there is a dependency because at each iteration, the unit's weights are modified. So for instance, in classification problem, when the Y target variable is categorical, the observation that have been misclassified in the starting iteration receive an higher weight in the subsequent iteration. So it means that observations that initially were not well classified are become more important in the subsequent iteration. So in being classified correctly in the subsequent iteration of the procedure. So we have a number of iterations, and the nice feature is that here we have a gradient that introduces a loss function that avoids the overfitting. The overfitting, as I was saying before, is the major risk when fitting these statistical learning methods. In our case, overfitting means again that I'm searching for a subset of few relevant predictors of the target variables, and basically the procedures end up with a high number of X variables that are found as good predictors of the target variable. But in the practice, it is not true because the algorithm has been not trained in a correct manner and has identified random pattern as a systematic pattern. And so basically some X variables have been identified as predictors of Y, but they are not. So in R, the XGBoost procedure has been implemented in the XGBoost package, which can be used for practical purposes. Let me, I've seen that it has already been used in some presentation. So I have already the packages that are installed on my machine. Okay, so basically now I train the XGBoost tree using cross validation. This is the train function, is a function made available by the caret package. So food is the predictor variable. The usual formulation means that all the variable including food in this data set should be considered as potential predictors of food. So now I'm using a statistical learning procedure XGB3, and the procedure is fitted using a cross validation with the 5 folds. again, it will take some time. Also, in this case, as you can imagine, the time is due to the fact that we are dealing with a large data set. Even though we have not a high number of potential predictors as in other applications that were presented during the conference. So here, you know, you should check also here there is a warning related to the use of an argument that is deprecated and basically, it is suggested to use another argument. The fact is that obviously we are not using directly the package, but we are using a wrapper, so a package that is used to call different available statistical learning procedure and that facilitates basically the training of these statistical learning procedures and their use for and interpretation also of the results. Okay, hope that we will reach okay, so basically here there is the output. These are basically the different arguments and parameters that were considered in fitting the procedure. So obviously before running the procedure, it would be preferable that you know exactly what is the meaning of each tuning parameter, because XGBoost is powerful but has many potential tuning parameters. And here we have within the package this very important variable importance function. So basically only the 20 most important variables are shown out of 23, and they are here sorted in terms of importance. So here furnishing is identified as the most important, followed by household income, by household site, and miscellaneous expenses for food. Then you see clothing, hotels, and so on going down. So basically many variables here are listed. But if you look at the top variables, you see that we identified basically the same variables that were identified in the ad with very rough procedure on the data. So if I have to end my presentation here, what is the important thing is that, okay, you have now a lot of procedure in R that you can be use for identifying the predictors. Some of them are simple to apply and fast. Some other are more complex, even though manage automatically some of the predictors, the fact that some predictors are continuous, the fact that some other are categorical, so you do not have to do transformation. However, statistical learning methods often require can identify nonlinear relationship between the data, but require a higher time for running and for training for identifying the parameters. So in most of the cases, you realize that the results that you get with these complex procedures are nothing else than the results that you obtain in this with a very rough and basic procedure. So having this in mind, consider every time which is the objective of your analysis, and so make, before starting with a complex analysis, try to understand whether it is the case of spending the time in running and in training and running complex statistical learning procedure rather than using very basic methods that are fast and rapid. So it's up to the time that you have, to the problem that you have, to identify which is the best procedure. Obviously, I just listed some of the available procedures. Many other are available there. The other suggestion is, as I was saying before, be careful when using statistical tests in complex with the data from complex sample surveys, because the statistical test may be not valid with the data, because if the sample is not basically a simple random sample. So in some cases, basically, you identify as significant something that is not significant because of the problems in the sample. So I would stop here and just leave the 5 remaining minutes of this tutorial for questions concerning the presentation, obviously, if any.
Thank you so much, Marcelo, for this interesting presentation. The topic is quite interesting for the official statistics, for the production in statistics. I saw we had earlier a question, you already replied. So we will see if there are some others who want to address some questions. Everyone is welcome.
Yeah, obviously, usually, you know, after tutorial, people need some time to digest the material. And so it happens. Even I have to say that in my experience, this tutorial is now part of one of the specialized R courses that we are providing to ISTAT staff. So we have a number of courses related to R that we give to our staff during the year, and this tutorial has become part of the courses that are done. And I realized in the first edition of the course that I had last year that basically many questions arrived later via email, even because, you know, there are many people that in the end are interested in these new methods like statistical learnings and want to learn more beyond also the objective of this tutorial, that is the basically just the identification of a few relevant predictors to be used for imputation for these purposes. So there is just a note from Mark which suggests looking at the recipes package. No, I have not yet used it. And I will use for the future, because obviously Caret up to now has been a very important tool for fitting many different statistical learning procedures, starting from one wrapper pay package, instead of installing, you know, every time the package. So for sure I will shift toward the recipes package. Thank you, Mark.
Thank you for your contribution, Marcelo. Okay, now Now we can have the well-deserved lunch for today. So we have 1 hour of break to have the lunch. And after we will be back. So please stay tuned for the second tutorial of Euros Conference, which is probabilistic record linkage using RecLean by Anne van der Land from Statistics Netherlands. So see you in 1 hour online.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you also.
Thank you, Marcel.